As we came towards the culmination of our organizational growth, we were particularly concerned about when somebody felt they were unjustly treated, and especially when it was somebody in leadership who they felt were abusing that authority. How do we deal with that? And do you remember how we worked on that, Dara? Do you want to reflect on that?
I remember very, very well. And so we begin to think about how to do this in the most just way, begin to talk to various people. And we set up in a very elaborate way of the person that was directing here, and then the person that was over them, and then two up or two down. We had it very, very clear who was to go to who for what. What was completely forgotten about that was the relational element. How do you come in and help anybody solve any kind of problem that you have no relationship with? So I'm the national director, or you're directing whatever you're directing. You don't know that young person. You may not even know the leader well to know how to even discern what could possibly be going on. And I worked hard on that area.
Yeah.
And people would lean into me how to apply it. And honest to goodness, Lynn, I don't think it ever worked.
No, I don't think so. I think it used up thousands of hours of people's time.
Exactly.
Never satisfied anybody.
Exactly.
What was your take on it?
There was a geographical issue, too.
Yes.
You know, under your leadership, let's say you're over Middle East and Africa as well as Europe, and somebody up in Finland has a difficulty, and another one in South Africa, another one West Africa, and so on, all at the same time.
Well, I just love to travel.
Yeah, of course. But even if you traveled, you can't be at all the places at once. And so God had another way. And we were looking at what Jethro said to his son-in-law, Moses, back in the 18th chapter of Exodus. And so, well, it looked like that's the way it was. What we forgot is that was government.
Yeah.
That was not in our lane.
Yeah.
It was not a mission.
Yeah.
And so I most recently have been thinking about longevity. When you look at governments, if they last very long, like Britain does, it's an amazing thing in history. But most governments don't last very long, especially if you go to Italy.
They've got a new one today.
Yeah, they got a brand new one as we're making this. Very, but we could have said that a few months ago, too.
Yeah.
Government is not long to exist. Or you look at business. How many businesses can you really say, well, back in 1874, they started, and so on. It is so rare. And right now, they've just come up with research on this, that the Fortune 500 companies in the United States that are owned publicly on the stock market, they last an average of 15 years. What they do, they don't say, oh, we gave up. They merge. Mm-hmm. Yeah. They do various things, but they only last that long. What is supposed to last? The church.
Yeah.
It's 2,000 years old. And it keeps going. It takes different names and different forms, but in essence, it's the same apostolic succession. But that is relational. That is one to another, to another, to another. It's the laying on of hands, Acts chapter 13. And so you see all of this taking place, and it keeps going right on and on. Now you even take missions. Look at the oldest, like Francis of Assisi. And or Dominican or Jesuits or some of the older ones. And I had the privilege of meeting Mother Teresa out in Calcutta. And when I met her and saw her workers, it was all relational.
Yeah.
She was not a tyrant. She was not a director. She was one of them.
Yeah.
And when I walked in, there was no appointments. There was no appointment books either. It was just, she looked up at me, how can I help you, you know, and such eyes of love. And it's the love factor that allows you to submit to an eldership that is important.
Yeah.
But leadership is servant leadership. It is not directive leadership.
Recent psychological research shows that like most of the rest of living creation, we are socially hierarchical. That is, you know, whenever you enter into a group, you kind of find your place, and when you know your place, you're comfortable and all. And of course, a lot of people really don't like that. So they want to do away with hierarchy, and yet we're hardwired for it. And of course, the Jesus answer is that the higher you are, the more you serve, and the more you love, and then nobody resents it. But if we go back into our history, we got stymied over this justice thing, and but it wasn't just, it wasn't frustration by any means that caused us to change. It was the word of the Lord again. And very often when God wants to say something that is a turning point for us, He'll speak to you, Lauren, and He'll confirm through Dar, and you brought a word, first time we ever met in China. Wasn't it?
Yeah, that was in 2002.
Yep.
Nanning, China. We were meeting together in a spiritual eldership. And I had just been on an 11-day fast down in Australia. And the Lord spoke to me about the tripod message. And that was showing there's the eldership, there's also the youngest in coming in, but there's also the ones that give us teaching from outside and so on. We had a threefold deal. And when I understood that, I realized the eldership was the part that was missing.
When you think about the tripod, if I can just add, was under the word of the Lord. So that
in fact,
was,
the Lord was up here.
The tripod. It was the word of the Lord, and it was our fellowship together.
That's right.
And it was respecting the word of the Lord in the youngest one amongst us.
Yeah. That's right.
And I even saw it, I've had performed some marriage ceremonies, of course, through the years with YWAMers, but it was like a two-dimensional triangle. And you see the man and the young man and young woman coming together in marriage on the basis of truth at the bottom, Jesus at the top. And the closer they get to Jesus, the closer they get to one another.
Yeah.
And that works also in a spiritual, relational eldership, where as the leaders, spiritual leaders, and Paul said to Timothy, he said, appoint elders there, and he was young, and he said, don't let any man despise your youth. We're talking about spiritual maturity, not an age, but a spiritual maturity. And you can spot them in a group, like you say, with the sociological concepts. You can spot each other because you just see them. And that's the way that people want to submit to loving eldership that have truth and they have Jesus over them. And the word of God comes down. And as it comes down and it's confirmed in more than one way, you're going to see a group of people, if they're submitted to the Lord in humility to serve. Mark 10, Jesus said, I didn't come to be served, but to serve and give my life for many, a ransom. And so as you watch what Jesus did, and then more along that line in the book of Acts, you watch, it's the spiritual apostolic people who had been with Jesus, and they were ruling elders, to use a term in the Bible. And as they were in that location, they spoke out, and they had something together that was really important.
That word, when you spoke it out in Nanning, it was a crucial turning moment, but we didn't know that. Mm-hmm. I didn't, anyway. I thought, I get that, and in a way, it was nothing new.
That's right.
But it actually was a word which often is the case where the Holy Spirit speaks something that you've heard before, but it's a new application of it. So the word about eldership, that's a biblical word. We were familiar with it. But it was really a signpost for us, I think, you're supposed to go to eldership.
I think, Lynn, too, at that point, all of us recognized we're drifting. We're having more business meetings than we're having prayer meetings.
Yeah.
We used to come together and worship the Lord and have a time of repentance and a sweetness in the Spirit. And now we were coming together and it was point one, point two, this agenda item, that agenda item. And the relationships were just kind of put all aside to get the business done. And we knew something was wrong with that, even though the motive was to do God's work well.
Yeah.
There was not a wrong motive in that.
That word began to change all that, but we didn't see it. Because
that's right.
Actually, I don't think we were supposed to at that point, because we went on and appointed John Dawson as president, and then Ian Muir as director, and me as chairman, and we carried on with those titles and directors everywhere. But gradually, we began to realize, now, we're supposed to do away with this. And I think the first thing we did was for John and Ian and myself to just lay down our titles and say, you know, we're not doing that anymore. And then teaching on eldership came to us from different sources.
Yes.
For me, I remember my dear friend, a Coptic Orthodox man, Dr. Atef, giving such a clear teaching on eldership and the dangers of having a king. Mm-hmm. Directive leadership. Mm-hmm. And I think the way I see it now is it was saying, you know, if you pattern yourself after government with empowered positions, especially with finances behind it, then it's just like it was with Israel in 1 Samuel 1 through 8. If you appoint a king, he will tyrannize you in due course. And so we started doing away with all those titles. And that was 2009 that we had a time in Lausanne, Switzerland, where we had a clear picture.
Yes. I'd like to bring up something earlier, though. In 1981, we were meeting here with our international leaders coming together. And we all laid down our titles and our responsibilities before the Lord. And we used the metaphor of Moses throwing down his staff.
Yeah.
And so we did that like a physical action. And then we went away to seek God, came back, and then that's when the Lord began to give us revelation. He gave us the best clear revelation when we were not holding on to titles or anything. Otherwise, you're trying to get yours in the agenda. You know, you come with your agenda rather than asking what God's agenda is. And that was an eldership act.
Yeah.
And I remember using the name president and feeling more comfortable with it because it's presiding elder was the way it was originally meant to be. And but it didn't ring like that anymore. It really meant you were the head. Now watch out and do what I tell you. Type thing. But the other sign I saw was the bottling up in some of the most dynamic places in the world by this directorship. I am the director. Don't you come here unless I tell you.
Yeah.
Don't you do these things unless I tell you, and so on. And when you see that happening, you see the Holy Spirit backing off.
Yeah.
And you see multiplication, you know, being lowered. And you see that even in churches where, in certain countries where they, you know, the pastor is the boss.
Yeah.
And from then on, and what happens to the young people? They all scatter.
Yep.
They're looking, where do I fit? And that means they're really looking for freedom to see what God wants to do in and through them. So being youth with a mission, we were never allowed to go very far that direction.
Yeah. That's right.
Otherwise, we'd become an organization. And at the time, as we were moving there, people said, we need to change the name. That doesn't fit us.
That's right.
And we said, well, wait a minute. God has called us to be youth with a mission. And we say that at our age, that's what we are. But we are there to submit and serve the young people, not control them.
That brings us up to a point where what we appeared to do was make a really abrupt change in 2014. But I think, as we can see, there was a long lead up time. So I think let's take a break and we'll come back and talk about the change that we made started at that time. And then a little bit of the practicalities of how does it work now? Because I think there are lots of questions about, okay, now we're more family, less organizational, but how does it work? So we'll take a break and come back to that.